Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab series on current sense amplifiers. My name is Patrick Simmons, and I'm an applications engineer in the current sensing and position sensing product line. In this video, we will focus on how temperature affects various error sources in a current shunt monitor measurement. If we look at any given data sheet, we can see information relating to temperature scattered throughout several tables. The first table temperature is typically presented in is the absolute maximum ratings table. There you can see what operating and storage temperatures it can survive before degrading or failing. The range you find in this table may be wider depending on whether you are looking at a typical commercial device, automotive qualified, military grade, or space grade device. Beyond the ABSMAX table, you will see the electrical characteristics table. Above the table, you should see a temperature or temperature range over which the majority of the table specification measurements were collected. For specifications collected over a different range, you will see some temperature range specified in the conditions column. In previous videos, we introduced the root sum of squares, RSS, which is a total error equation for current sense amplifier circuits, as shown here. This video focuses on error related to temperature. A quick glance at the formula reveals that there is no specific term called E temperature. So, where is the temperature error contribution then? Turns out that the impact of temperature needs to be included in the calculation of multiple error terms found in the RSS formula. The relevant error terms include gain error, shunt tolerance, and input offset voltage error. When incorporating temperature in these error calculations, you often will need to use a unit called parts per million, PPM. PPM is a unitless coefficient adopted by the scientific community for expressing a very small fraction, such as 5 PPM would equate to 5 units out of a million units. As we often calculate the percentages for our error sources, we simplify our equations involving a PPM coefficient to being multiplied by 1 over 10,000, as shown on the right. So, within the RSS formula, it's possible to generically lump all terms into two categories. One category is gain error, and the other is voltage offset. The gain error subset includes specifications for gain error, nonlinearity, and shunt tolerance. Typically, the nonlinearity error is quite small, and the magnitude it drifts is even more negligible, and therefore, it is not typically provided in the datasheet. As for the shunt tolerance, this specification is typically found on a separate datasheet, as only a few current shunt monitors include an internal shunt. For gain error at room temperature, you would just need to pluck the max specification from the datasheet and plug it into the RSS formula. However, if your temperature is not 25 degrees Celsius, you will need to incorporate the gain error drift coefficient as shown in the formula here. Delta T corresponds to how far the temperature is from 25C, or the typical temperature stated right above the electrical characteristics table. Let's work an example. We plan on our device operating in an environment with a max of 105 degrees C, and we need a 500 volt per volt gain. So, we decided to use the following device. From the electrical characteristics table, we see that the gain error at 25C is plus or minus 0.4%, and we see that the max gain error drift is 7 ppm per degree C. If we plug our operating conditions and the device specifications into the gain error equation, we get 0.456%. If this yields more error than you can stomach, you could consider heat sinks, or you could choose a different device. When choosing a different device, you will often find that a better drift specification often accompanies a better gain error specification. As we stated before, the shunt resistor tolerance will not typically be found in our current shunt monitor datasheets, as most current shunt monitors do not include an internal shunt. However, there are a few devices that do feature an internal shunt. One device in particular is the INA250, shown in the upper table. In this table, we see that the INA250 internal shunt can range from 1.9998 milliohms to 2.002 milliohms. To get the shunt tolerance in percent form, we would simply take the absolute value of the typical subtracted from either the min or max. We would then take the quotient of that value divided by the typical. Lastly, we would multiply by 100% to get the percent value. In the second table is an example extracted from a datasheet of a resistor manufacturer. From their table, we see a given shunt might come in a variety of tolerances with different drift performance. In their table, the temperature coefficient is under TCR, and 10 to the negative 6 is substituted in for what we would normally have as ppm. Shunt tolerance, very simply, is a linear adder. A 1% shunt resistor will contribute 1% error, while a 0.1% shunt will only contribute 0.1% error. The trade-offs of the shunt tolerance are the physical size of the shunt resistor and the cost. That said, the real gotcha with most shunt resistors is the temperature coefficient. Shunts with 1% or even 0.5% tolerance are easily found and can be priced very reasonably. However, when you need to drive stability over temperature, is when the shunt becomes expensive. The additional error is very easy to calculate, just like the additional error seen with gain. So, to see the drift impact of different drift coefficients, let's look at an example with some drift coefficients you may run across in a part distributor's website. Here we look at 0.1% at room temperature resistors. One has a drift coefficient of 15 ppm per C, another at 100 ppm per C, and last at 200 ppm per C. We expect the ambient temperature range to fluctuate by as much as 100 degrees Celsius. Based on these conditions, the max operating temperature for the 200 ppm resistor will result in nearly an additional 2% error, while the 15 ppm resistor adds 0.15% to the initial 0.1% error. What becomes evident is that for high accuracy shunts, the temperature coefficient can become the dominant error source. As we do have some devices with an internal shunt, let's work an example. We will use the INA250, and we will assume that the device will be subjected to the max recommended operating temperature of 125°C. Using the shunt tolerance equation we had before, we know that the shunt tolerance error at 25°C is 0.1%. When we account for the drift from the temperature at 125°C, we see that the error becomes 0.35%. When we recall from the last slide that external shunts can significantly increase the error as the temp coefficient increases, we can understand the value a device like the INA250 provides. The internal shunt provides good trace matching, reduced board space, and most importantly, minimal drift across temperature. One shunt implementation that may be tempting to try is a copper board trace. For applications in which precision is paramount, we highly recommend against this approach. The primary reasons are as follows. The board manufacturer does not have perfect manufacturing capabilities, and therefore, the sample of boards produced might have much looser tolerances than what can be accepted. Second, copper is highly sensitive to temperature. Consequently, as the ambient temperature changes for our system, the trace shunt may see large changes in resistance. Related to this is the third reason. The very current you pass through the trace will produce heat in either the trace or in adjacent components, which then leads to changes in your resistance. As you might question how significant the impact of temperature on a copper trace is, let's work an example. Opposed to the example of the internal shunt before, I will use a relatively smaller temperature change of just 40°C. The copper resistance equation uses 20°C instead of 25°C as the reference temperature. Our expected max temperature is 60°C. The typical copper coefficient for this equation is 0.00393. If our resistance is 1 milliohm at 20°C, we can expect it to be 1.157 milliohm at 60°C. This drift shifts the resistance such that it now has an error of 15.72%. This doesn't even include the error introduced from manufacturing. Now let's cover the last error source influenced by temperature that is typically specified in the datasheet. Voltage offset error referred to the input. Unlike the specifications from before, you will notice that the offset drift is typically specified in nanovolts per degree C. This is because the entire change in offset over temperature needs to be compared to V cents. Now let's work an offset drift example. Because of the low offset voltage specification, we decide to work with the INA190, which has an offset drift of 80 nanovolts per degree C. Our max operating temperature is expected to be 85 C. Minimum voltage across the shunt is expected to be 10 millivolts. Plugging the conditions and specifications we have into the voltage offset equation equals 19.8 microvolts. If we take the ratio of the voltage offset to V-cents and multiply by 100%, we get 0.198%, well under 1%, even after the offset increased by 1.32 times. Let's take a minute to summarize what we learned in this video. Temperature affects gain error, shunt tolerance, and input offset voltage. Drift specifications often have either ppm or some unit of voltage per degree C. Lastly, avoid copper traces for precision measurements. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of the content. For more information and videos on current sense amplifiers, please visit ti.com/currentsense.